Good news. God calls us to this time of worship, and God welcomes all. Friends, let us join together in worship as we sing our first hymn, number 683, Lord of All Hopefulness.
Thank you.
Gathering on Sunday, August the 30th, the final Sunday in this month. While it seems like all we've had this year is just one continuous day, it's true that the months are clipping by rather quickly. So we're glad you're with us for worship today. Those who are members of Celebration and friends of Celebration and our Facebook Live followers everywhere, thank you for helping to form this community that is coming together for real worship together today. I trust that each of you continue to be safe in your places of social distance, and I want to thank you for adapting your lives in these unprecedented times for the safety and well-being of us all. Friends, hear the call to worship. From whirlwind and burning bush, in still of night and sheer silence, God calls the faithful to sacred work, beckoning us to turn aside, inviting us to stand on holy ground. God welcomes the faithful into sacred space. Come now, friends, God is calling. Let us worship the triune God in spirit and truth. Please bow with me now for prayer. Loving God, in a world that is ever-changing and in a society that has all but rejected the truth of your word, I thank you that you are our never-changing Savior, who knows the end from the beginning and has the universe in the palm of his hand. Develop in us an unwavering trust in the hope that is set before us, knowing that in Christ we have already received your gift of eternal life by grace through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. May we learn more and more of your divine character and perfect attributes. For the more we know you, the more we trust you, and the more we trust you, the more we come to love you. Develop in us an unwavering hope in you and your promises, knowing that despite the evil and wickedness that seems to be suffocating all that is good and pure, your plans and your purposes for humanity and your world will one day be brought to fruition. On that day, Christ will be all in all, and the whole world will be brought into submission under his feet as he rules and reigns on earth as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May we have living hope in Jesus unswervingly and live our lives to your praise and glory, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join our hearts and voices together in singing number 726, Will You Come and Follow Me?
Thank you.
Share several important announcements. Our Celebration preschool teachers are back in the facility here at Celebration this week and early next week, getting things prepared for their reopening on September 8th. So it's coming, and it's coming fairly quickly. So please pray for our teachers and staff and students and their families. Also, on Wednesday, September 2nd, coming up this Wednesday, we will have a Celebration community Zoom. This is the purpose of bringing us together. We had one last month, and we started looking at our biases and prejudice. So we'll continue that conversation with another YouTube that will sort of prompt our conversation. So see the link in your weekly update that has come out from Celebration to join that community Zoom gathering to look at our biases and prejudices. Remember, friends, that even in extraordinary times like these, you are the church and I'm the church and we are the church together, even at a socially safe distance. I thank you all for your ongoing participation, generosity, and support here at Celebration. Please join us in our continued call to prayer each day at noontime, remembering our congregation, our preschool, our mission partners, Presbytery, Synod, and General Assembly. Thank you for lifting all these needs up in your prayers. Now, let us say what we believe as we share the Apostles' Creed as our affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As in recent weeks in our worship, as we prepare our hearts for sharing our joys and concerns and spending some time in prayer together for our congregation, community, and nation, let us sing together hymn number 407, verses 1 and 4 of Spirit Divine, Attend Our Prayers.
Prayer list, I
lift up the following names that have been shared with us. Cherry McCoy, this is Linda McCaskill's cousin, still battling the COVID-19 virus. Janet and Jimmy Rakes. Janet is battling small cell lung cancer. She is home. However, she's traveling back and forth to receive treatment at MUSC. Excuse me. Please remember Ken Krenzer's son, Chris. Chris is home recovering from a major bout of Crohn's disease, pancreatitis, and bronchitis. Chris and his wife, Diane, live in Cornelius, North Carolina. Please remember Larry and Pearl Abrams. Larry is still at Myrtle Beach Manor, recovering from a brain aneurysm, and Pearl is recovering from a broken arm. Please remember the family of June Marcus, who died at home on August 24th. No memorial service is planned. Please remember Alan Perry and Sandy as well. Alan is undergoing treatment for liver cancer. At his recent follow-up at MUSC, it revealed that the tumors are responding favorably to the treatment and shrinking. So we say thanks be to God. Please remember Leslie Eckert's daughter, Colleen, who's having health issues that they're still monitoring. Please remember Char Marie Wenzel, still recovering from a surgery. Also, Dave Berry is home recovering. And after his visit this past week for follow-up at MUS or in Charleston, they've said he has 3 more weeks of antibiotics. Thank you for your ongoing prayers for my father, Robert Dendy. Prayers for healing, prayers for hope. He is at home. Now, as we begin our prayer time, I'm going to invite you to name aloud your joys, your concerns, those for whom you wish that we pray. Let us bow together. Oh God, this year, 2020, with the COVID-19 virus, has brought much pain and chaos and uncertainty to the world and to our lives. But we are trusting in your faithfulness and love to sustain and care for us and for our loved ones. Oh God, we ask, how long will this madness last? We're surrounded on all sides by our enemies of fear, despair, anger, and grief. Many of our plans are crushed or postponed until further notice. Our calendars are emptied of our must-dos. Our companions have become images and voices on computer, phone, and tablet screens. The invisible terror of this virus lurks on the hugs of love, the breath of friends, and in the constant panic alerts from our devices. But then we remember that you, O Lord, are our shield and our strong tower. You are the lifter of our heads and the light that makes our way clear. We take small steps, holding your outstretched, germ-free hand. We cannot hold the hands of others yet. We can hold each other, however, in prayerful love, walking together with courage the way before us as our enemies fall one by one until life breathes easy again. Then, like eagles, we will soar and not zoom. Then we will join the joyful parade of those who go to your holy house and lift the roof with hallelujahs and feast without cares at your table. O Lord, who makes all things work together for the good of those who love you and those who are called according to your purpose. So many of your churches are unable to meet in person today. Work this for good, O God. Open hearts and minds to new ways of connecting, worshiping, praying, and serving. Bless internet connections, telephone networks, cameras and mics and finances. Give pastors and technical people wisdom and peace. May these services not be poor imitations of a televised service, but a new frontier of real interactions as the body of Christ. Let us use this time to equip families and small groups of neighbors to be church and to have church. And when we can come back together again, which we pray will be soon, and with all our people, let us remember what we will have learned, and let it make us a better church. May we who are merely inconvenienced remember those whose lives are at stake. May we who have no risk factors remember those who are most vulnerable to this virus. May we who have the luxury of working from home remember those who must choose between preserving their health or making their rent. May we who have the flexibility to care for our children when our schools are closed or partially opened remember those who have no options. May we who have to cancel our trips remember those who have no safe place to go. May we who are losing our margin money in the tumult of the economic market remember those who have no margin at all. May we who are settled in for quarantine at home remember those who have no home. As fear grips our country, let us choose love during this time when we cannot physically wrap our arms around each other. Let us find a way to be the loving embrace of God to our neighbors, and especially those with need. We pray that your peace would fill our homes and our hearts, even as we feel the heaviness this year has brought. May your grace be a beacon that draws others to the goodness of your gospel. By your Spirit, help and heal all who have need in body, mind, and spirit this day. Uplift all those that we have named today in our joys and concerns. Bless our church and our nation, Lord, as we struggle with age-old issues of hatred, distrust, bigotry, racism, and violence. Help us to learn the values of anti-racism and to practice. We confess our complacency and failure to act. Even as yet another black man has been shot multiple times by police during an arrest. Give us a voice to speak for unity and courage, to work together with all people for unity. We pray a special prayer for protection for all healthcare workers, support staff, and first responders who are risking their very lives for the care and saving of others. Protect those who are in hospitals, ERs, nursing homes, homeless shelters, rehabilitation facilities, those living on the street, those living at risk of domestic violence during these times of social isolation. Protect all who are having to work under risky conditions to support their families. Oh God, keep them safe and keep them strong. Give wisdom to our church, community, state, and national leaders, and help them continue to bear the burden of wise decision-making for us all throughout this global pandemic. Grant us wisdom and courage and hope for the living of these days. And now, O God, hear us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us sing verse 5 of Spirit Divine, attend our prayers.
Spirit.
Friends, as we come to the time of receiving tithes and offerings, I remind us that it takes all of us praying together, pulling together, working together, giving financially together, especially in these exceptional times. Through your love and generosity, you are keeping the church's mission and ministry supported, secure, and sustained for the weeks and months to come. And with great humility and sincerity, I say thank you. Please continue to give generously in supporting Celebration Presbyterian Church. We remind you, you can give by mailing your checks to the church or sending your check through online banking bill pay or through our church website. You may use the donate now option. And if you prefer, you may use the recurring payment feature. Thank you, thank you, thank you, friends. Let us continue to worship God as faithful stewards. Thank you, Sarah, for that musical offering. Friends, let us join our voices in singing God's praise as we share the doxology with Alleluias. Please bow with me for our offertory dedication prayer. May our offering be an expression of genuine love that reflects your love for us, O God. We seek to honor you as we serve one another in Christ's name. We reach out to overcome evil with good. Direct our use of the resources you entrust to us, that we may not only contribute to the needs of the saints, but also devote our lives to the building of your peaceable worldwide kingdom, in which all are valued. Amen. Friends, today our scripture lesson is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and following. It actually goes through verse 9. So let's prepare our hearts and minds to hear and receive God's word, first with a time of silence, followed by our prayer for illumination. Let's bow together. Living God, help us to hear your holy word, that we may truly understand, that understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience through Christ our living Lord. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I want to begin with a little bit of backstory on this scripture. Our scripture lesson is from the epistle of 1 Peter, and though we can't be totally sure about who wrote this book, there's good evidence to suggest that this letter did come from the hand of the disciple Simon Peter. And for over 30 years, this former professional fisherman had been fishing for men and women, and he had not lost his enthusiasm for the work of the gospel. So let's listen to what this disciple Simon Peter had to say. Hear the word of God. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm reading first from the New Revised Standard Version, and then later I'm going to read from the Message. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfaded, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And now listen as we hear Eugene Peterson's twist on the new life that Peter is describing here. What a God we have! And how fortunate we are to have him, this Father of our Master Jesus. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we have been given a brand new life and have everything to live for, including a future in heaven, and the future starts now. God is keeping careful watch over us and the future. The day is coming when you'll have it all, life healed and whole. I know how great this makes you feel, even though you have to put up with every kind of aggravation in the meantime. Pure gold put in the fire comes out of it proved pure. Genuine faith put through this suffering comes out proved genuine. When Jesus wraps this all up, it's your faith, not your gold, that God will have on display as evidence of his victory. You never saw him, yet you love him. You still don't see him, yet you trust him with laughter and singing. Because you kept on believing, you will get what you are looking forward to, total salvation. Friends, this is God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God. So the title of this message is, We Have Hope That Is Alive and Eternal. Now, a little more of the history of this letter itself. First Peter is a letter to early churches that are located in the area that is modern-day Turkey. And unlike many in the New Testament that maybe were written to a particular congregation or a particular individual, this letter is considered a general letter or a circular letter, meaning that it was a letter written by Peter that was passed from church to church to church, from community to community. And it's thought that Peter wrote this letter somewhere around 64 AD, which means after the time of Jesus' birth, or approximately 32 years after the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. Historically, what was happening during that time was the vast Roman Empire was being ruled by Emperor Nero, who reigned from the year 54 to 68 AD. Nero has a terrible name among Christians, and with good reason. In the year 64 AD, two-thirds of the city of Rome was burned by a horrific fire, and many historians believe Nero himself was responsible for the fire. And Nero needed a scapegoat for the fiery destruction of Rome. So he laid blame on the early Christians. And as a result, the Roman Empire began to persecute Christians as never before. In fact, the name Christian became a derogatory name associated with those who followed Jesus. Christian tradition tells us that both Simon Peter and the Apostle Paul died as martyrs under the rule of Nero. Tradition also says that Peter was made to watch while his wife was crucified, and then he too was crucified, though Eusebius, who's an early church historian, says Peter demanded to be crucified upside down on a cross because he said, I am not worthy to die in the same manner as Jesus Christ, my Lord. When I think about Simon Peter and his disciple journey with Jesus, there are several descriptive words that come to mind. When Jesus encountered him, he was a fisherman, turned fisher of men and women. He was a family man who had Jesus heal his ailing mother-in-law. He was impetuous, he was impulsive, even violent at points in his following of Jesus. He was passionate in his confession on the road to Caesarea Philippi when he said, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. He was willing. Only Peter, you recall, stepped out of the boat and attempted to walk to Jesus when Jesus was walking on the water. Peter was devoted, saying that he was willing to stand with Christ come what may. He denied. He denied Jesus three times. And yet he was the only disciple still standing near enough to Jesus after the arrest to be recognized by the crowd as being one of Jesus' followers. Peter was shamed. He was shamed by his own behavior in denying Jesus, and the fact that Christ had predicted it with him and he did not believe it. Another word is restored. After Jesus' resurrection, he was one of the first disciples to the empty tomb on Easter. He recognized Jesus later on the beach while fishing, and he jumped in to swim to Jesus on the shore. And there, Peter, who had denied Jesus three times, experienced what it meant to be restored. Three times the resurrected Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" And three times Jesus charged Peter to be a good shepherd in taking care of his sheep and feeding his lambs. Another word for Peter is grounded. Peter founded his life's purpose on this resurrected living Jesus, and he would devote the remainder of his life after Christ's resurrection to sharing the good news of Jesus with both Jews and Gentiles alike. He had a rock-solid foundation. Jesus renamed Simon to Peter, and he said that upon Peter and his ministry, he would found and grow the church. Both the words Petros and Cephas, from which Peter's name is taken in the Greek and Aramaic language, mean rock or stone. So he was that rock upon which Christ would build. He was a leader. He's often referred to in history as the Bishop of Rome or the Bishop of Antioch, a city where many Gentiles were converted to Christ. Antioch was the first place where Jesus' followers came to be known as Christians, which was a curse word. It was a slang word that was derogatory for them. Peter was a disciple who knew firsthand of God's grace and mercy and forgiveness and powerful love that can restore the broken and fallen sinner and empower that person to rise up and to serve the risen Jesus. In this general letter of 1 Peter, he's writing to encourage early Christians that were having to live with persecution. They were suffering. They were living in fear for their lives. But rather than focusing on their trouble and their persecution, he focused before them on the faithfulness of God and the generosity of God's promises. Rather than focusing on their trials and their troubles, he focused on their living and eternal hope that was born out of the living, resurrected Jesus Christ, who calls each of us to live an Easter faith. Because we know he lives, we can live also. He says, Peter says in writing to them, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Does it sound like Peter is writing to someone in distress when he reminds them and reminds us of our call to a new birth that fills us with a living hope? Today, we can't watch the news or listen to any politician's speech without them mentioning hope for the future or hope for change and somehow linking that hope to themselves. But what is hope? When you or I talk about hope, it usually is in reference to something that we are wishing for or something we strongly desire to happen, but something we cannot guarantee will happen. Well, hope is more, friends, than just wishful thinking. It is, for the Christian, something that's so much more than wishful thinking. I'll say there's no certainty that the next president will be able to bring about the needed changes that he talks about to fulfill the hope that each presidential candidate is offering for our nation in their speeches, in their rhetoric, and in their promotions. Hope for politicians, and perhaps for us as well, is what we desire to do or to see accomplished. It basically refers to, in the political sense, helping us realize the American dream to have a good life, the better life, to prosper, and to feel security. But does hope really mean that same thing for Christians? Peter's first letter gives us a clear understanding of our hope and where it comes from, and what it means to us in our daily lives and in our eternal salvation. The hope that he's talking about is not the same hope that we hear espoused by politicians or their political ads. As followers of Jesus, our hope is given to us by God, and it's based on the promises that God has made to us. Our hope comes from the one God who keeps promises with real power and real authority. Our hope that is alive and eternal comes from Jesus Christ, who is our living Lord and Savior. Peter writes to remind us that ours is a living hope and an eternal hope. It's not something that's transient. It's not something we wish for by and by. He says the future begins now. Hope must be based on something. Or more importantly for us as Christians, we know that it's based on someone. If you've ever been down and out and have lost the focus of life, you understand what it means to be hopeless or to be washed out with hopelessness. Perhaps you've placed your hope in work or in marriage or in the day-to-day routines and struggles, and you found that they failed and that your hope was gone and that you felt dead inside, hapless and hopeless. Years ago, psychologist William Marston asked 3,000 people this question: what do you have to live for? 94% of the respondents said they were merely enduring their lives, hoping someday that things would get better. Well, I suppose this is an expression of hope to a small degree, hoping that the future will be better than the past or the present. But if our only encouragement is found in hoping for a better tomorrow, is that really an adequate hope? It's been said that some people see only a hopeless end, but the Christians see an endless hope. Some people see only a hopeless end, but for we Christians, we see an endless supply of hope. 1 Peter tells us that hope that is alive and eternal, these come from the living Christ. That's why they are eternal, endless. Peter writes to a people that were in the midst of very difficult time, persecution, hardship, they were threatened, and yet he offers them hope, real hope that is alive and eternal. COVID-19 has put our world in danger, and many people are facing hardships and job losses and fear for their very lives. Further on in this passage, Peter writes, "And though you have not seen Jesus, you love him, and though you do not see him now, you believe in him. You greatly rejoice with joy that's inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls." This is a kind of hope that speaks even to a COVID-19 world. Living hope, an inexpressible joy. You think about joy that bubbles up, but what is inexpressible joy? It's joy that just goes beyond our ability to even describe it. What strange language to use with people who are undergoing such suffering and hardship. Living hope and joy that's inexpressible. That's a strange offering for people who are fearful for their very lives. So what are we missing here? How can you have such inexpressible joy when your entire world, as you've known it, is being torn apart? Clearly, such hope and joy are not just shallow emotions or wishful thinking or based on current events or current candidates for office. This living hope and inexpressible joy penetrates our very soul and our entire being to the very heart of who we are becoming as followers of Jesus Christ. As followers of Jesus, our hope that we've been given is alive and eternal because God is supplying it, and it's based on God's faithfulness to God's promises. Our hope comes from the one God who keeps promises, who has real power, real authority, and real love for you and for me. Even amidst the COVID-19 pandemic, hurricanes, floods, earthquakes, racial tensions, financial strain, political stress, family stress, school stress, my friends, our hope is based on someone, not something. Our hope is alive in Jesus Christ, our living Lord and Savior. And our hope is eternal, which means our hope is alive in Christ today and tomorrow and the day after and forever. So we're to hold on to hope no matter what may come against us in this lifetime. Friends, I ask you, on what or on whom are you placing your trust and your hope? Our Christian hope is living and dynamic. It's refined by trials and tough times that we face and endure as we live into the fullness of the kingdom of God that begins here and now with Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns forever, and who has promised to be with us always, even to the end of the age. And I say, how good of God, who creates us, saves us, sustains us through all the perils of life that we face, and who sustains us with hope that is real and alive and eternal in Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Friends, I thank each and every one of you for supporting celebration by your participation today in this real community gathered for real worship. And I thank you for your ongoing prayers and financial support as well during these challenging times. Remember these events: Tuesday evening virtual Vespers with me at 7:30 p.m., then Wednesday, September 2nd at 7 p.m., we'll have a community Zoom and we'll look at bias and prejudice and continue our conversation. Thursday evening will be Beer and Hymns with Sarah Abushakra, and that's at 6:30 p.m. And then we'll join together again next Sunday morning at 11 a.m. for more real community gathering and real worship through Facebook live stream. Now, hear these words of assurance. Biblical hope is not wishful thinking. It's a confident expectation based on the promises of God. And Paul's benediction found in Romans 15:13 reminds us that God is our source and our continuing supplier of hope. God is able to fill us with joy and peace, even in and especially in difficult times just like these, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Our role is to keep placing our belief and our trust and faith in God. Hear his words from Romans 15:13, where he says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope." Now, friends, receive this benediction. Go forth into the world with compassion and justice in your heart. Give voice to the silent and strength to the weak. Hear one another, see one another, care for one another, and love one another. It's all that easy, and it's all that hard. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. And all God's people say, amen. Our final hymn is "Give to the Winds Thy Fears," and it's number 815. Let's join together in singing.
With patience, he so shall this.
Of slowing down here in Horry County. So keep doing your part to slow the spread of this deadly virus. And remember, God loves you, and so do we here at Celebration Presbyterian Church.